Good morning or good afternoon, as the case may be. As I already mentioned, I'm going to cover the ZOS Communication Server Resolver. We're going to start out with an agenda. I'm going to cover the introduction to the resolver, the actual resolver address space, how to control the resolver address space, how to customize the resolver, the APIs that are included with the resolver, and then we'll have a little picture of putting it all together and some maybe just a basic scenario, and then I'll have a link to some very good reference material for basically everything that I covered, and then we'll have two Q&As. I'll stop in the middle for some Q&A, and then at the end we can have some additional if there's more questions. So let's get started with the introduction. The resolver basically acts on behalf of programs that perform the following functions. It will access name servers to provide name to address or address to name resolution. So if I have a name, I can resolve that host name to an IP address, or if I provide an IP address, I can resolve that IP address to a host name. So it depends on what the application wants to do with the resolver function. Part of the processing that a resolver does is it'll allocate and read a TCPIP.data file, and I'm going to use that as a synonymous term. The TCPIP data file can refer to etcresolve.conf or any other file, and you'll see that as we go a little bit further in the presentation, but I'm going to use that TCPIP data as a general term. And it doesn't mean necessarily the TCPIP data data set name. The other thing that it does is, and it can do, is it establishes stack affinity for certain socket applications, socket APIs. So if you had a multiple stack environment or common INET, the resolver will be used to actually establish stack affinity. And optionally, you can use the resolver to do protocol and services information. So from ETSI services or ETSI protocol, you can get protocol information for applications. And that's more of a little used function of the resolver, but it's there just the same. The way the resolver will complete requests from programs is it will access available DNSs or domain name servers if they're configured. If there's DNS information that has been previously cached on the ZOS system, if you have caching enabled in the resolver, we will access the information from the cache. Or you can optionally use local definitions if either the resolver can't locate that information in a DNS, i.e. the DNS doesn't have that information, or the application specifically says I don't want to use DNSs, I want to use my local files. The resolver will use those local files. And lastly, the TCPIP.data file controls pretty much everything that the resolver does. And the resolver can be configured to basically allow every application to use the same TCPIP data file or a default TCPIP data file, or you can use a native search order, which I'm going to cover in detail, where depending on the API, the resolver will search for specific TCPIP data files to use for the resolver functions. So again, the resolver is used to communicate with domain name servers, or for short, DNS. DNSs, for those that aren't familiar, contain information on a host basis, for instance, IBM.com, Yahoo.com, Google.com, any main domain name will be in a DNS. The DNS entries also include aliases for the host names. In this example, I have a name that we call Buzz for one of our hosts that we have in here in Raleigh. There'll be IP addresses assigned to those host names. Obviously, that's going to be the main purpose of the resolver, is to resolve that host name to an IP address. You're going to have canonical names or CNAMEs, which are aliases for another domain name. Those are included in the domain name server records. You'll have a time to live value, which indicates how long that entry is valid for, and it requires the DNS to actually go update once the time to live expires and get a new copy from a database in case something's changed. For instance, in our case, if you had dynamic VIP addresses or DHCP dynamic IP addresses, you'd have to go resolve that name to a new IP address on a periodic basis. And then there's other information like mail exchange points or MX records for short. And the main purpose of the resolver is to improve usability to end users. Obviously, it's much easier for an end user to use a host name than an IP address. And you can see that now that we're in the IPv6 realm, and if you're using IPv6 addresses, there's an example of a really complex-looking IP address for IPv6, and obviously you can see how much more user-friendly it is to have a host name instead of an IPv6 address. So the resolver provides the following basic services. It does name resolution. So again, I provide a name, and I get an IP address returned. So, and here's some examples of a ping. I'm going to ping a host name called meatball.tcp.raleigh.ibm.com, and I'm going to get back an IP address for that host name. I can telnet to another host. I can FTP to another host, and I'm going to get back the IP address for that host. So you're going to normally use a resolver function to obtain the IP address so the subsequent connect or UDP send to can be done using that IP address returned from the resolver call. You can also use the resolver to do reverse name lookup. And that means I'm going to provide an IP address and I'm going to get a name back. And one of the most one of the examples we chose here is a traceroute. A traceroute command, even though I'm passing a host name for the traceroute command, I'm going to get back IP addresses of all the routers that I've traversed to get to that destination host. And you can, by default, allow traceroute to take that IP address and convert it to a host name. And that's the example that we chose here. And then the last one is an example of what an MX record would look like in a DNS. So if I was a mail or SMTP or CSSMTP and I needed to resolve a domain name to get the mail exchange address, I would do that using the DNS or resolver services. So what the resolver does in a nutshell, it provides application APIs, and the APIs we provide go across the board. We have C, C++, Assembler, Rex. You can use COBOL. Pretty much all the languages that we support in ZOS will have a resolver API function available. Those include the TCP/IP socket APIs that we ship, part of ComServer, as well as the native Unix LE or C++ or native Unix callable BPX1 or BPX4 API calls, as well as Rex. The APIs we include are a get host by name or a get adder info, which both are used to get a name and get an IP address returned, or a get host by adder or a get name info, which again are both used to get pass an IP address and get a name. And then we have some direct high-level Rex callable services that will call the DNS directly. And those are usually up to the application to do their own resolving functions. And those are only available in C++. And I'll get to the APIs as we go a little further in this presentation. The resolver will form and send DNS queries, and we base our queries and our APIs that we're going to use to communicate with the DNSs on two RFCs, RFC 1034 and RFC 1035. And you're welcome to read those two RFCs if you like some more detailed information on the resolver APIs. We're obviously, if we send a request to a DNS, we have to process the DNS responses. So we have to handle error situations, negative responses, as well as working scenarios in the resolver. Optionally, you can cache the results from the DNS, and we cache those results in ZOS, so the first call will actually require a call to a DNS, but any subsequent call for that host name or IP address will be included in the cache, and you'll see very positive performance improvements every time we have to go to the cache to get results instead of actually going to the DNS, because obviously there are network flows that have to take place. The resolver actually will monitor for non-responsive DNSs. So based on your thresholds, and I'm going to get to those a little more as we go a little further, the resolver will monitor how often and how many queries were sent to DNSs and how many of those DNS queries received a response. And we'll put a message to the console indicating that there may be a possible problem with a DNS or a list of DNSs. And then optionally, we'll use local host tables. So you can do a host name. If you change a host name and you want to test it, instead of going to DNS, you can use your local files. Or you can test the host name before you actually make a change in your DNS. Or you may actually want to use local host files, which are manually updated, instead of using a DNS. So let's move on to the resolver address space. This is the first thing. The resolver address space is a very integral part of ComServer. The first thing that needs to be understood is you can't do any productive work in either TCP/IP or in an application until the resolver started. And I have a picture of here shooting yourself in the foot. So if you don't know the resolver started, you can see some really crazy results. For instance, TCP/IP will not start until the resolver address space is active. And we'll put out a message on the console saying we're not going to initialize until the resolver address space starts and completes. The resolver address space, you can run the resolver address space as a default, which means you don't have any customization. In that case, we'll use a normal native search order to find all the TCP/IP.data files that we need for an application to use to make a successful resolver call. And I'm going to cover that in more detail as we go along. Now, there are some simple customization steps. Again, this is all covered in our documentation, but I just wanted to highlight it here. You're going to obviously create a start procedure for the resolver. You have to customize the resolver using a setup.dd statement where you're going to point to a setup file, which includes some control information for the resolver address space. And again, I'm going to cover that. Your resolver proc has to be set up to access your setup.dd file, and you have to have an OVS segment for that. Just like any other application that's going to issue socket function calls, it requires an OVS segment. And again, we recommend, and I'm going to cover this a little more, stress that we recommend this, that you have the resolver started by the Unix System Services or OVS address space when it initializes. And you do that by adding a resolver underbar proc to the BPX-PRM-XX sys1 parmlib member that is used by Unix System Services when it initializes. So moving on to how we're going to start the address space. The resolver address space can be started in two ways. Again, the first method is what we recommend, and it can be in this method, the resolver is started when ZOS, Unix, or OMVS is initialized. This method allows the resolver to be up before any applications are actually started, so you won't have any failures if an application tries to do a resolver function call and the resolver address space is not up yet. So this is probably the most convenient and easiest way to do things. And again, you do that by updating the resolver underbar proc statement in BPX-PRM, which is in sys1 parmlib. So if you use that method, you can pass a real proc name for the resolver, or you can use default settings where OMVS will start a proc named resolver, even though a proc named resolver does not exist in your system. And if that's the case, you're going to have only default functionality for the resolver, and we'll cover that a little bit more. Or again, you can use automation or a normal start procedure to start a resolver proc. And again, this is probably not the best method to use because you have to have your automation in place to ensure that the resolver address space is up before both TCP/IP and any other applications are started, so you don't have any unnecessary failures. This is an example of what that resolver underbar proc statement looks like in BPX-PRM-XX. Notice you have three options. You have the first one, which is a proc name, so you would actually use a proc that you have defined in your sys1 proc lib, which is named resolver for the most part, and that proc will be what the OVS will use to start that proc representing the resolver. None is not something we recommend doing. That means that we're not going to start, OVS will not start any resolver at all, and that is up to you to actually start your own resolver address space using the prior method of automation or just manually via start procedure. Or again, you can use the default method, which allows the OMVS address space to start a resolver proc, which is assigned the name resolver, even though a resolver proc by that name does not exist in your system. And it's going to inherit the default behavior of resolver. Here's an example of what a resolver proc would look like if you had one defined in your system. The first line, there's parms which point are required, which point to our ctrace, which is internal tracing for the resolver, and it has a ctrace member which represents the ctrace parameters that the resolver actually resolver address space will use. So you would only use that by the support center actually recommending that you set a resolver trace enabled for specific problems that we come across. Notice again, there's a setup DD card, and I'm going to cover that a little bit more, but that DD card is used for the resolver to gather some configuration information that it needs to set up the environment. And I'm going to cover that in more detail. FOIL 11 is how you are different methods of controlling the resolver once the address space is started. The first modify command is a refresh. And that refresh command would be used, for instance, if you had a TCP/IP .data file that needed to be changed. For instance, if you had to change your default domain name server address and you wanted that change to be picked up by the resolver, you have to issue a refresh command, and the resolver will then go and read the defined TCP/IP data file that it has defined in its setup file, and it'll pick up the change for that new DNS address. Now, keep in mind, once the change is made, the applications that were using the resolver are not going to automatically pick up that change. They have to now do a new resolver function call to pick up the changes that were done by the change that you made in the TCP/IP.data file. The other method is you can do a modify setup equals, where you can actually pass a new setup file to the resolver address space, and it actually does two functions. It will actually reread the setup file and also do a refresh of all the TCP data.data files that it has defined. The other modify command that we supply is a modify proc, or in most cases, modify resolver, display. And the output from that display command will return all the information that you have defined that has been read and processed by the resolver of the setup DD statement. And notice these are some of the statements that we're going to cover a little further in the presentation that relate to the statements in the setup file. For instance, you have a default TCP/IP.data definition, and it points to the file or the data set representing that default TCP/IP.data. The other modify command that we included involves our caching mechanism that the resolver can optionally use. By default, we enable caching in the resolver, so that means that any DNS responses that we get, either positive or negative, and negative means a request that came back from a DNS indicating that the name or IP address that the application was looking for is not found in the DNS. So that's considered a negative response. So any positive or negative response will be stored in our local cache on ZOS. Now, the TTL that I mentioned previously in the DNS record can be overwritten, and I'm going to talk about that. But in the setup file, if you look in the display information that I have above, you can see the max TTL. The max TTL is a method that the resolver can use to override the TTL that it receives from a DNS. So that allows our cache to be purged, or that entry to be purged when the TTL time to live value expires. Now, if you had bad entries in there and your TTL was not set to something reasonable and you wanted to flush your cache, you would do a modify resolver, flush, all. And that flushes all the cache entries in the resolver, not just the specific domain name or IP address. Unfortunately, we don't have that functionality to allow a specific name or IP address to be flushed from the cache. It's either all or nothing. And then the other example I have is a display command, which is done via netstat, RESC, or -q, which will display the resolver cache. You can't use netstat to delete cache entries, only display. And there is no display function within the modify to display the resolver cache. So it has to be done via netstat. And then the last two control statement ways of controlling the resolver are using either a stop or a start to stop the resolver proc or start the resolver proc. And normally those wouldn't be used very often, but they could be used if you're going to have to install some resolver maintenance that requires the resolver to be reinitialized. So once you install the maintenance, you'd obviously stop the resolver using the P command and then start the resolver using the start command. This foil on page 13 represents statements in the tcpip.data file that can be refreshed. So not everything in the tcpip data file can be refreshed. So this list contains all the statements that can be that are refreshable. So if you made changes to any of your tcpip.data statements that the resolver is using and is processed, and you do a refresh, then these will be updated. So anything that's not on this list obviously won't be refreshed, it's not refreshable. So let's move on foil 14. Let's talk about different ways to customize the resolver, or the different ways there are to customize the resolver. The first definitions that we need, the resolver needs to be concerned about, are the resolver setup statements. These are the statements that are contained by the setup DD statement that's in the resolver proc. And the setup file contains things like what files to use. For instance, if you have a global TCPIP data or a default TCPIP data. I'm going to cover these a little more, so I'm going to go over these a little quickly, but I'll cover these in a little more detail. But a global TCPIP data statement is basically a method for the resolver to set a default TCPIP data file for all applications running in an LPAR, no matter what socket API they're using. And I'm saying that now, but the socket APIs are important because it allows the resolver to have a different search order based on the socket APIs, and I'm going to cover that. I don't want to get any more confusion to it right now. The other thing that the resolver statements contain are ways to control your localhost search mechanism. So if you decide to have common search enabled, then you can have a global IP nodes or a default IP nodes file that will be used for your local search mechanism for localhost files. Caching. I mentioned we have caching in the resolver, which will allow you to cache negative or positive responses from a DNS. And there are statements to control that. By default, caching is enabled, but if you choose to have caching disabled, and I have a typo here, but it should be no cache instead of you can enable cache by default, you can have no cache, or you can have your size of your cache file. I believe by default it's 200 megabytes. You can change that size if you need a bigger cache, depending on the number of cache entries you might have in your system. And you can override the max TTL that the DNS is returning for each of those cache entries. And then there's another option called unresponsive threshold. And this is the threshold that we use to determine if a DNS is unresponsive or not, based on the queries that are being responded to by those DNSs or listed DNSs. The other statements that the resolver will use indirectly, I mean these are not defined in the resolver address space in any way. They're defined basically for applications using resolver calls, and they control things like what DNSs will be used. And that is controlled by the NS Interadder, and that's going to be the actual IP address of the external DNS. Now, when I say external DNS, starting in V2R1, we no longer ship the bind9 DNS, so you don't have a ZOS DNS running in the ZOS address environment any longer. So they're going to be external or on your network. So you'd have an IP address of a DNS on your network. Some of the other parameters. Keep in mind the TCPIP.data file contains many parameters statements, but I'm only going to cover four or five of them that relate to the resolver. The other one that is really important is resolver timeout. And this is used to allow the resolver to how long the resolver function call is going to wait for a response from a DNS. Now, keep in mind, the longer you wait, the longer the application is actually suspended waiting for a response to come back. Years ago, we had a default timeout of 30 seconds, and that used in accordance with resolver UDP retries, which is the number of times we actually retry, can make a resolver function call wait for upwards of 1 or 2 minutes based on how long your retry interval was and your retry timeout value. So we recommend now, I believe our timeout is set to 5 seconds. Now you can actually go down into the millisecond realm. So in a network, if you have a very responsive DNS, you probably want to look at some of those resolver timeout values. They may be a little high, but 5 seconds may be applicable or may not be applicable. But just a couple things to keep in mind. And the last parameter that I want statement that I want to cover is domain origin, and that is used as a way for the resolver, when it issues a resolver function call, it appends that domain origin onto the host name that was sent from the application. So, for instance, if you ping Meatball, for instance, if I say ping Meatball and my domain origin is raleigh.ibm.com, I'm going to append the function query that I will send to the DNS would be meatball.raleigh.ibm.com because I'm going to append that domain origin to that request. And I'm not going to cover all the statements that are in the TCP/IP.data file because some are really not related to the resolver. But again, those are all covered in our configure reference, and it has full details and all the rules of the syntax. And then the last thing I wanted to cover is your local files, local host tables, and those are used either by themselves or in accordance with DNSs if names or IP addresses are not found in DNSs. An application may request to use local files, which are manually updated, that reside in COS either on the Unix file system or in an MVS sequential file. And they're maintained locally. They're flat files that have names and IP addresses that we support both IPv6 and IPv4. So here's an example of what the setup file would look like, and this is pointed to by the setup DD statement in the resolver proc. The first statement that I have uncommented here is your default TCP/IP data file. I apologize, I probably should have used a different name just for sanity reasons, but this default TCP/IP data file is the file that every application in your LPAR that's using resolver function calls will use to obtain information like the domain origin or the DNS address that we're going to use for DNS queries. I'm sorry, default name is the last name that we would use in the search order, and I'm going to cover that a little more. The global TCP/IP data is the statement that's going to be used by everybody, every application that's using resolver functions in this LPAR. And then I have another example of global IP nodes in here. Notice they're commented by the colons in the profile, in the setup file. So here's some examples of some of the statements in the resolver setup file. Common search or no common search, I mentioned those are used in accordance with global IP nodes or default IP nodes if you want to use if you want to control what local files are used. Otherwise, we're going to use our normal searching mechanisms that are defined in our config guide, and I'll talk about those a little more too. You can turn cache or no cache. Obviously, cache is on by default. If you don't prefer to have caching on, which is something I wouldn't recommend, you can turn it off by saying no cache. You can set the cache size. Again, the cache size is set by default to 200 megabytes. The max TTL by default is set to infinity. If you want to have your max TTL overwritten, you can do that. Your unresponsive threshold can be controlled by the unresponsive threshold parameter. And I already covered the global TCP data, default TCP/IP data, global IP nodes, and default IP nodes. A couple notes here. The files that are pointed to in the setup statement can be either fully qualified MVS dataset names or HFS files. And I gave some examples on the methods of coding those if you use either method. And there's some rules here for the sequential file name. It has to be either a fixed or fixed block format, and it has to be an LREC between 80 and 256. It could be a sequential or a PDS member is allowed. So this on FOIL 17, I think this is a very important thing to remember here and keep note of. Every address space is going to have their own TCPIP.data file that it's going to use for resolver functions. And the address spaces get those files by using specific search orders based on the APIs that they're written in. Now, that's one of the more difficult concepts because you're not going to know, unless it's your own application, homegrown or written in-house, for the most part, what API your application's using. So it sometimes makes it a little difficult for application or system programmers to control what application, what TCP data files the applications are going to use. So when we get to that, that's why it's highly recommended that you use a global TCPIP data file so you don't have to go through all the headache of knowing what API your application uses, and based on that API, it's going to have a different search order on what files it uses. So I wanted to just define what we call what the APIs. We have two specific APIs and we have two specific search orders based on those APIs. Native MVS. That includes the TCPIP supplied CSocket API, which only supports IPv4. The TCPIP Pascal sockets, which very few applications, with the exception of SMTP and LPD that we ship, that are written in. Most, I don't think I know of many applications that are vendor or user written that use the Pascal APIs. TCPIP REC sockets, or the TCPIP socket extended APIs, which include EZA-SMI or EZA socket or SOCket callable services. The other API type is ZOS Unix. That includes the language environment C or C++ sockets, or the ZOS Unix services callable BPIs, which are BPX1 or BPX4 callable services. So those are the two classifications, and those are the two classifications that the resolver uses specifically to search for specific TCPIP data files for that application, if you don't have a global TCPIP defined. So here's a little bigger picture then of how this search order might be initiated. First of all, the resolver address space is started with a setup DD statement. And the setup DD statement is going to point to a data set name called user1.tcpcs.tcpparms member RS setup in this case. The box underneath, which is really a representation, which is what is in the RS setup member, contains a default TCPIP data file, which points to another PDS, and a global TCPIP data, which points to a PDS representing that global file. Now, this is used, and I gave three examples here, of a native MVS socket program, an LE socket program, or a USS callable sockets program, which is really lumped together with LE C++. So those two are similar in their search orders, with the exception of the resolver underbar config that you see in the middle box in step two in the search order. So the way this is going to work is, since the resolver is set up to have a global TCPIP data file, when the application issues its resolver function call, the resolver is going to search for a global TCPIP data file. If one exists, the resolver will use it. Simple. You don't have to worry about the API any longer. The application will use all the parameters that are defined in that global TCPIP data. All the applications will use the same DNSs, will use the same timeouts, will have the same information across the board. Now, the complexity gets in if the application or the resolver was not set up to have a global TCP data. We continue on based on the application's API using specific search orders. So in the example of an application using a native MVS socket program, the next thing it would search for is a sys-tcp-dd statement from the application's application's proc. If that exists, it'll use that. So I think you get the principle there. It'll keep going until either a file matching these requirements is found, or a default TCP data found if one is defined, or nothing is found, in that case, you're going to have an error on your resolver call. And I think I talked about that a little bit more. As we recommend in a single stack LPAR, which is not using common INET, we recommend that global TCP IP data be used. The main reason is it reduces the complexity for all these search orders and what files are going to be used by what applications. So continuing on, this covers just a little bit more of what I spoke about. And the thing of note here, the search continues until a match is found. So if a match is found, the resolver will use that specific file or HFS file or member an MBS sequential file or PDS and provide that information to the application for its resolver configuration unless one is not found at all. And I wanted to put a little note on the bottom of here, just an FYI. TCP/IP actually uses a search order to get its host name, and that's the only thing that TCP/IP uses the resolver functions for. So the misnomer was that any resolver function called issued by an application went through the TCP/IP address space. That's not true. It's actually handled directly between the application address space and the resolver address space. There's no TCP/IP involvement here, except for the fact that TCP/IP is used to actually send the packets out to the DNS and actually get the responses from the DNS. But TCP does use the resolver search order to locate a TCP data file to actually find the host name that's used for the host name representing this TCP/IP stack. And then the next foil on page 20 represents the search order that's used for native MVS applications. Again, global TCP/IP data is used first. If it's found, great. If not, we continue on the search order. Going back on slide 19, I wanted to make a point or a little warning here. LE applications or C++ applications can fork or spawn threads in their applications. If they do spawning, if the application proc was set up to use a SysTCP DD card, that SysTCP DD card will be lost when the forking is done. So that's just a little note. We actually wrote our FTP client to actually handle the SysTCP DD card, but there are cases where applications that do spawning and they use the SysTCP DD card will lose that resolver information. So I just wanted to make a note there. So you might want to use another file in the search order to actually obtain the TCP data information if you're not using global TCP/IP data. So continuing on to FOIL 21, this is a little caveat with the global TCP/IP data. Just like anything, we have our little gotchas. You can use a global TCP data file, but if you don't include all the statements defined in the lower box in your global TCP/IP data file, it will use defaults. However, if any of these other statements are found in the native resolver search order, they will be replaced and used in accordance with what was used by what was found in the TCP/IP data file. So you want to be careful on, even though you're using a global TCP/IP data file, you still want to be careful and cautious and be aware that we're still using the native search order that I described in the prior two FOILs to find statements that may or may not be included in the global TCP/IP data file. And the point that I wanted to make out would be the trace resolver statement. The trace resolver statement is used to turn on debug tracing, and it's used for service, or you can use it yourself to actually trace what the resolver did. It shows the function call being sent to a DNS and the response from the DNS if there was one, or if that response timed out. But the point I wanted to make is you don't want to turn trace resolver on globally in a global TCP/IP data statement, because that would mean that every application that issued a resolver call would now have resolver output in its sysout, which may or may not be something you want to see. So that's just a word of caution here. Let's continue on with the Resolver APIs. The Resolver APIs, I'm going to lump these together. The getHostByName and the getHostByAdder are used to do name to address resolution or address to name resolution, respectively. Now, the key point here is they only do IPv4. So if you have an IPv6 requirement, you can't use getHostByName, but don't fear, we have APIs that support IPv6. The information that's going to be returned by these is something called the host end structure, or it's going to be with an eye catcher of EZB-REHST. We call it our host end structure. It's going to contain things like the canonical names, the DNS is returned, or CNAME. It can contain the alias names for the host names, and it can contain up to 35 different IP addresses for the host name that's being resolved. And that's returned to the application, and the application then has to use that structure and take the information that it wants out of the structure and use it accordingly. Now, conversely, we have getAdderInfo and getNameInfo, which basically do the same function calls as the getHostByName and the getAdderByName, where that it does name to address and name address to name resolution, but it supports both IPv4 and IPv6. The other thing that these APIs support can support services information, in that you can get port information or server information for services that I didn't cover in this presentation because they're not highly used, but there are applications that would like to get information on well-known ports based on a job name of an application. They can use the getNameInfo socket function, which in one of the many flags and port parameter that's passed to the getNameInfo can actually obtain the services information. Again, the getAdderInfo returns an AdderInfo structure, which is the EZB-REHST structure, and it's very similar to what the getHostByName or getAdderByName will actually return. The only caveat here is the application using a getAdderInfo has to do a free AdderInfo call. If the application doesn't do a free AdderInfo call, these thread structures will build up in private storage in the application, and there could be a possibility that there could be a storage admin because we've run out of storage because AdderInfo structures are filling up storage. So that's one thing that the application has to be aware of. They have to do a free AdderInfo to free the structure after they're done using it. So let's put this all together. What I try to represent here is the three functions at the top would be, the one all the way to the left would be an FTP using an IP address as an example. So I'm going to use an example of, I'm going to FTP from TSO using IP address 10.1.1. Obviously, since this is an IP address, we're not going to require a resolver. So FTP doesn't need to call the resolver to look up that name because it has the IP address. It's just going to do a connect directly using, or a send to, if it's a UDP application, using that IP address. So there's no resolver function that has to be used at all here. The benefit to doing an IP address is it's fast. We don't have to call the resolver. We don't have the overhead of going to the DNS to get the response back, or not finding the name at all. I have an IP address, I'll just go directly there. It's also good for debugging. If we have a problem with looking up a host name, for instance, if an FTP using a host name fails, but if it works using the IP address, then we know it's probably something related to the name lookup of that name that failed. And then the other big drawback is you have to remember IP addresses. IPv4 is not such a big deal, but as we saw in those IPv6 addresses, they can be pretty big, long addresses, and most people are not going to remember the IPv6 address of a destination, but they will remember the host name of that application. The second option, this is FTP using a host name, only in this case, the resolver was set up to only use local host files. And you can set the resolver up to use only host files, or you can set the resolver up to use a combination of DNS and local files. So it's a preference of how you want your setup to be used by applications on your system. If you want to manually control that using local files, you're welcome to do that, and you won't have any DNS issues to worry about. So this case, if you did an FTP to HostX, because the resolver was set up to use local files only, or the resolver tried to use a DNS and the name wasn't found and we're going to use a local file, we're going to actually go look up the local file based on the resolver lookup options that we're going to have set up, the lookup variable, the search order, based on the host names. So again, the benefit of using that, it's fast. You're not going to have any DNS overhead. The drawback is, as I just said, is you have to manually update that. So if IP addresses are changing on a regular basis or host names have changed, you're going to be out of luck. You're going to have some bad results coming back from your local files, and they have to be manually updated. The last option is we're going to do an FTP to the same host, only we're going to allow the resolver to actually use the DNS and try to find that host address. So we're going to go through the FTP is going to use a resolver get host by name function probably, or get host by adder function, and it's going to look up that name, and hopefully it'll get the IP address of that name that it returned. The benefit is this is all dynamic, so your DNSs should be keeping up with any changes in your network if host names or IP addresses have changed. So the DNS should keep track of that. And so the DNSs have a hierarchy, and they exchange databases with other DNSs. So you don't have to worry about anything on ZOS in this case. You let the DNSs handle that. The drawback is, again, there's potential for extra flows because the resolver has to make network flows to the DNS to actually get the results. There could be a little bit of overhead, but if you're using caching, the first resolver call for that host name or IP address will be the only one that should be experiencing any network flows. Any subsequent calls should be getting that information from cache. And this example on FOIL 25 kind of puts the same scenario again with a little different picture, and it kind of depicts the resolver routines that may get invoked. So in this case, we're going to FTP again, using FTP as an example, to another host. So FTP program will actually do a get host by name, passing host X as the parameter. So what's going to happen is the resolver address space gets control running under the application's address space, FTP in this case. So FTP will do a resolver call. That resolver call will space switch over to the resolver address space, but it'll still be running under the FTP thread. So there's no functionality that changes here. It's all transparent to the FTP client. It doesn't even know this is happening. The resolver address space will then go to its configuration and look up its setup and say, okay, do I have a global TCP/IP data file, or do I have to look up a file using my normal search order? And when it looks up that using that local search order or the global, it will find a TCP/IP that data file. In that TCP/IP data file will now be information like what domain origin am I going to use? What NS adder am I going to use? Am I going to use local files or am I going to use a DNS to locate this name? So based on that information, the resolver will either send that request to a DNS or come back and use the local files. In either case, the results are going to be returned to the resolver function, and it's going to return that IP address back to the caller, which in this case is the FTP program, and the FTP program will then continue on doing its connect using the host name that it was trying to resolve, in this case 192.168.1.1. A couple notes here. As I mentioned, the TCP/IP.data statement lookup will actually control if a DNS or local file are used by the resolver, and it'll also control whether one is used or both are used in the event that the results can't be found in one or the other. And the resolver IP address will be used. So if there's no name server address in the resolver configuration file, the resolver will look for local files. So we're going to use local files if there's no NS inter adder address in the TCP data file. And one thing to note, that the resolver normally uses UDP protocol and port 53 for a DNS, a remote DNS. Now that can be changed, but 99% of DNSs in the industry use UDP and port 53. And the reason they use UDP is because there's very little overhead, because all we do is send a packet and we get a response back. In TCP, it requires some session setup. We have to have a three-way handshake and set up the TCP session before data can be sent back and forth between the resolver and the DNSs. So as I said, 99% of the industry uses UDP and port 53 for their DNSs. And here's a bigger picture of what I just said. The application at the top will call the resolver APIs. Those resolver APIs will then invoke the resolver address space unbeknownst to the application. The resolver address space will use Unix system services, again, unbeknownst to the application, to do its application calls, because the resolver is going to be doing some send tos and receive froms to the DNS address. So again, this is all done transparently. The application doesn't even know it's occurring. Again, the TCP/IP address space is going to be involved because we have to actually send the packets out to those DNSs and then wait for a response to come back. When the response comes back, it's going to be passed all the way up to Unix system services, back to the resolver address space, and then back to the Unix application or the native MVS application that requested the resolver function. And the last foil is some reference material. The first book that I included here is a red book. It's very good. It's a great place to start. It talks about all the configuration that has to take place in the resolver, including the setup statement, the TCP/IP data search order, how the resolver finds the files, et cetera, pretty much everything I talked about. The configuration guide and the config reference guide are the comp server guides that we ship, and that will have more details as to some of the information that I included. For instance, all the statements that I talked about, and also includes all the TCPIP.data file statements that are included, not including just the resolver functions. If you're going to write a socket application, you're going to need to know what socket resolver function calls you can issue. So I included our TCPIP or comp server IP socket API programming reference and guide, and also the Unix system services assembler callable services reference. One thing I didn't include here is the C++ programmer's reference, but you can use that as well, because those three guides will be needed based on the APIs you're going to use. And I included the MVS init and tuning guide, which talks about the BPXPRM ParmLib member. And I also included at the bottom here some tech notes that the service department wrote. The first one is how to customize the resolver. Again, the second one is understanding how the resolver queries a DNS. And the last two are some tracing information, how to collect a resolver trace if it's requested, and how to actually look at a sys TCP RE resolver component trace if you want to do that, as opposed to looking at a resolver trace output.